Are you ready?
I am.
Are you ready for this?
Is this game gonna contain any triggers?
It could quite well contain some triggers that might there might be some offensive scenes, maybe. Okay. I don't know. If you're into animals, not in a bestiality kind of way, but
if you're into animals, not in a bestiality type of way, Thomas Corcoran, 2017. Shouldn't have said your name, should I, boy?
I think I said it in the last part, actually, so no worries there. But what I was going to say was, I don't need to finish it, I think you got the idea, but yeah, this is the obviously the level after the last one that you were in, and that was just a poster I was showing.
Okay.
That isn't supposed to be Bartoli, but that is the whole idea of this level is that it is his opera house, which you'll get to see a bit better up here. But it's kind of weird because you can't really tell whether it's in use or not. It just seems like it's kind of out of use and falling apart, and just like an old opera house from like sometime in the 20th century that's just out of use. But I really like the. Yeah, I'd say this is actually my favorite level out of the entire game. I think it is. There's something about it.
How many levels are there on the entire game?
I think there's close to 20.
All right.
I think there must be about at least 17. I'm pretty sure, at least. But
are there cutscenes in this game?
Yeah, there are cutscenes. There's a very long, good cutscene after this level, which you'll get to see. But yeah, what do you think to the textures here?
They're very RuneScape-esque.
There is something about it that just reminds me of RuneScape. I don't know what it is. People are probably going to hate.
The water really is similar.
I just think people are going to hate the comparison between Tomb Raider and RuneScape.
Don't want to trigger any Tomb Raider fans.
Yeah, it won't be the Tomb Raider fans, it'll be the RuneScape fans. But, yeah, you get hit with sticks a lot more in this level, but, I think this level is beautiful, but after what you said in the last part about just, it feels, every Tomb Raider level kind of feels just like, it just feels like a really strange dream.
Yeah.
It really does. There's just something about it that just
is the fact that it's also kind of disjointed. At least watching it, like maybe playing it, you know, like what you're doing, obviously. But like,
yeah,
just watching it is like it just goes from one thing to the next, like a dream.
Yeah, it really does. And you could say when I was like, I'd never really thought about it before you said it. Like, it does kind of. You could pretty much say it's about any game, I suppose, because every video game is kind of. It's got its own kind of reality feeling, but this is there's something about Tomb Raider and just it's just the textures and just the way that you're just doing so many just bizarre things, and there's just like random boxes swinging that looks like something out of it just looks like a dream. There's just something about it.
Yeah, imagine dreaming in those textures.
Yeah, I think we've I think playing this at the time was a dream. I think it is still a dream.
Those rune rocks.
I think it's supposed to be shattered glass or metal or some kind, something like that. But yeah, what we're doing at this point, to explain a bit more, is what we're doing is we're trying to gain entrance to or gain entry to Bartoli's opera house.
Right.
So this whole level pretty much takes part in or takes place in an opera house. And it's this level is there's a reason why this level is my favorite. It's just the way it's all designed, and it really just all fits together in a really interesting way, and you kind of backtrack without knowing it. For example, like this part up here, I just love this part, by the way. There's something about just falling structures that reminds me so much of PS1 games like Crash Bandicoot and things.
Well, that's quite cool.
Yeah. But that part...
Is it the kind of game where you know what you've got to do? Is it just you try and look for things and then follow it?
That's the thing. You really don't know what you're supposed to do. And it's like... You know generally what you... Well, I think it would be pretty far to... I think it's going pretty far to say that you even have a general idea of what you're supposed to do. I think also with just the lack of cutscenes and things, it just makes this game just feel kind of just really just surreal and just obviously you're just trying to you pretty much just try things the first time you play and figure things out, and the more you play, just the more you kind of get a sense of what you're supposed to do. And it really does kick in as well. Like, you just get a feeling of what you're supposed to do after a while. It's just kind of weird. But what I was going to say was the... that part you saw over there with the falling floor.
Yeah.
You actually, for example, you see that later on in this level, but from underneath.
Right, yeah.
So it's really... it's just really clever level design like that, and just this part here just looks so fucking weird. This
I can't work. Are you on top of a building, man? Or?
Yeah, that's the thing. It's just you can't really tell. But yeah,
I can't tell if you're in like a dungeon or just on top of a building. For some reason, there's just a swinging box.
Dungeon Raider.
Yeah.
Dungeons. One thing can be definitely said. I mean, this competes well against Devious Mud.
It doesn't have anything on Classic.
This is a single-user dungeon.
A sub. Just something about the name Devious Mud. It's just... Ever since you mentioned it that time, it's just like...
It wasn't even...
so either. Shady. No, about the name, like... Devious. Well... It's just a really weird choice of name.
It is very weird, I have to admit. But it wasn't me that mentioned it the first. I'm pretty sure you were the one who told me about Devious Mud.
I told you, but it's just you mentioned the name of it, like how weird it was.
Yeah.
Are these people you're killing like bodyguards or something?
They're Bartoli's henchmen. And this game has a lot of henchmen. Like in the later Tomb Raider games. Also, yeah, can you work out what this room is? I know I was only in it. I'll ask you again later.
A control room?
Yeah, it was really clever actually, the way that was designed. Because the first time I played this, that's the thing about these. At least the first three Tomb Raider games, they have, because of the graphics, they kind of, although I wouldn't want to play the graphics, but play a game with any different graphics, but you sometimes can't work out what things are. Mm. It's very difficult to tell what a room is supposed to be, but it's actually supposed to be the control room quite cleverly for the curtains and for the backdrops and on the stage of the opera, but.
Like a lot of PS1 games, the sort of size of the character compared to the surroundings is just really small.
Yeah, I know what you mean, yeah, definitely. That's definitely the case in Tomb Raider. There's a really great example of that in the next level after this, which I think I'll probably get you to be in, because I think you'll have a lot to say about that level. It's pretty... I'll let you see it. I'll let you see it. I think,
I'll experience it for myself.
Exactly, yeah. But, yeah, there's these fucking beds in that level that are just, like, they look like they're made for ogres. It's like, you see the shape of... Well, you certainly see the shape of Lara, but what I was supposed to say was the size of Lara.
Yeah.
And compared to the beds, it's, like, literally, like, Shrek was supposed to be in it or something.
A Shrek mashup. Please tell me there wasn't a Shrek game on PS1. That would just be so depressing.
What, you don't know about Shrek, the Shrek games on PS1?
Oh, I thought it was only on PS2.
No, I owned. Yeah, so you don't even know about fucking Shrek Treasure Hunt.
I remember it, but I didn't think that was on PS1.
Yeah, it was on. It was definitely. I don't know if it was. That's also just a great example again of just Tomb Raider, like just things trying to kill you from every angle. Because what the developers wanted was for you to sort of backflip back from those henchmen and to be hit by those boulders, pretty much. I think that's what they were going for. But what do you think to this room? It's pretty much like...
Why is there water in the middle of an opera house?
Yeah, that's what I was saying. Like, it just feels like decrepit, if that's the right word, or dilapidated. Just, it feels just... I don't really know...
I'll tell you what, those boulders falling are a bit of a health and safety hazard.
Oh, I know. Stick this fucking opera house in the UK and you'd have a lawsuit on your hands. Only in Venice. But yeah, I think now I think about it, the water pretty much just confirms the fact that it's supposed to be just falling apart, you know?
Yeah, I guess so.
But what do you think of this room? Because this is pretty much the main room of the entire level and you just kind of go around it doing different shit.
Yeah, as I said, it's really big. Like, it's weird though, like, because it isn't really that big in like comparison, but it just seems so big for some reason.
Yeah, there's something about it. Yeah, definitely. It just feels.
It's the same that's with what was it? The Harry Potter game, The Philosopher's Stone.
Oh, what an epic game!
I remember you took that off me. You wouldn't allow me to play it.
Yeah, because on the. Keeping in mind, just to explain this, this wasn't the PC version, this was the PS1 version, and the PC version, in all honesty, is okay. It's actually an okay game, it's not too bad, because it's actually quite different, but the fucking PS1 game is just, it's just a disaster.
It wasn't that
bad. It's just a disaster, it's just terrible. I've got it sitting next to me at the minute, the disc.
Do you?
It's in my...
I think you should do a playthrough of that. That's the next one.
It's probably one of the... it'd be interesting... I don't know anything about the voice actors in that game, because they must all just be British voice actors. I don't know who actually was starring in that game. But what I was going to say... Okay, now back onto the most important topic at hand, Shrek Treasure Hunt. So... Yeah, no, I had that on PS1, and I think it was rated at the time. I say at the time, like it was actually just reconsidered later.
Okay.
But it was rated at the time 3 out of 10. It was truly shit. It was so shit.
Yeah.
I don't have the disc. I don't know what the fuck happened to it. I probably just burnt it or something when I was going through my teenage stage. Yeah. But the
it's just the typical kind of thing you would do, just burn a Shrek disc.
But yeah, no, it was truly a terrible game. Like, it was really bad. I mean that it was just a terrible, terrible game. Like, the thing is, the PS1 could do so much. It was really just down to the developers, and especially in the later years when. You know, people kind of mastered their craft or were inspired by other, you know, kind of other developers and things. You know, you could really do a lot on it. And, you know, a perfect example of that is Spyro. And I think I've already said it, but the skyboxes in Spyro are just, you know, just phenomenal for the PS1. Yet, actually, in this game, in Tomb Raider 2, they are actually pretty shit. They get better in Tomb Raider 3, but the skyboxes in this level... Not in this level, but... you can't really see them in this level, but in a lot of the levels, they are just really... It's just the lack of blending. If you're with me, if you are in the next level with me, with moi, you'll get to see probably the best example of a skybox, of a daytime one, because... there's this. The next level is the offshore rig, and you get to climb to the top of the actual rig, and you get to see the sky properly. But
right.
What do you think to all this? What do you think? I'm looking once again at one of my cue cards here. What do you think to all this, like, underground stuff or underwater stuff?
Was it Tomb Raider that you said the swimming sort of controls were really good? I know you said that about Spyro, but
yeah,
what do you think?
Spyro the freaking dragon. Yeah, the swimming in this game, I think it is close to being as good as Spyro, in my opinion.
Yeah.
It is.
What I do remember about the underground bits in this game and, like, the swimming was that it really felt like, it really created a sense of panic when you couldn't see anything and you were about to die.
Yeah, definitely. I think that happened pretty much mainly. I think playing back through these, honestly, I'm enjoying them more as an adult than as a kid. But, like, obviously it's a lot less difficult as an adult, and really, I think mainly that came from, like, the from playing as a kid. But that kind of reminds me of something. Like, it's these games, like, don't you think they just feel, like, so lonely?
Yeah, that's a good point, actually.
Like, they just feel just kind of...
They do feel really empty.
I know you can't hear the game audio at the minute, but, like, it's pretty much... There is no music whatsoever. And there's just, at times there's music, like, if you get a surprise, or if you uncover something, or if you reach a certain point, it's pretty much triggered by where Lara is standing. But the only audio you hear is the actions and pretty much ambience.
Right.
So you hear kind of creepy sounds. And this level is actually fairly, I think it's fair to say it's spooky.
Yeah, it does create a sense of, like,
the textures here remind just me of
being alone. Yeah.
Yeah, definitely. The textures here reminds me a lot of Resident Evil.
I was thinking that earlier in one bit where you were in that control room, but for some reason it just reminded me of you playing that.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. Yeah. There's a lot of points in Tomb Raider that reminds me of the first Resident Evil games. But to say that they were pre-rendered graphics, I think this competes really well with it, you know. Yeah, so this is where we would have fallen to our deaths if we had, you know, the
know
what I'm talking about.
I remember now, yeah.
This room is just fucking incredible, just the sheer scale of it. Look how big it is.
Oh, you're all the way up there. I wasn't expecting it to be that high.
I know, that's what I mean. It's just fucking huge. It's a behemoth of a room. No, that's not really a good use of that word. That was shit. But
it's a gargantuan.
Yeah, room. That's a lot nicer. But yeah, we pretty much this level is all based around the kind of, for lack of a better word, like the hub of the main opera room where the stage is. So you go around all these different areas, but it's pretty much all based around that one area, and you have to go up and down between levels and things in the elevator. And this is fucking retarded, this bit. Like, you pick up a circuit board, but it's been soaked in water.
Yeah, that is pretty bad, really. Like, it doesn't have to be incredibly realistic, but that is a bit
shit.
Yeah.
No, I seem to have memories when I was younger of really disliking the swimming in Tomb Raider, but honestly, as an adult, I just really enjoy it. I think it's done really well. I think honestly, in terms of real, like, it's on par with Spyro, definitely. I think the only reason why Spyro was better was just because it's just more fun, just because it's less real. But in terms of realism, this is definitely a good example of swimming. Because, you know, like, even GTA 5 was pretty, like, underwhelming. Don't you think?
Yeah, it could have been a lot better. What really annoys me, as somebody who still plays that, one of the like five people who still use that on PS3. But when you're facing the camera, when you're swimming, when you try and turn around, it just doesn't work.
Yeah,
like it takes a lot of like I don't know. It's just like, yeah, it's just really annoying. It never really works the way you want it to.
Yeah, it's pretty. Just, I would just describe it as standard. It's like run of the mill swimming, really. I mean, it's not that bad. It's good. But it's like standard good. It's not like incredible. I think this is supposed to be the dressing room for the opera house. So it's definitely like, just wrecked and just.
I think they should just hire the person who made the swimming on Spyro just to work on GTA 6.
Yeah.
The swimming.
I just love this whole level and just the textures of this game and this level in particular. It's just incredible. But funnily enough, you were talking about Spyro. I actually watched a video earlier on Facebook, of all places to watch a fucking video. I just think Facebook is cancer and just
amongst the
it's just I just I just videos. Hate Facebook in general and just how videos, like the kind of style of videos that end up on Facebook. But Insomniac, the entire crew at Insomniac, which is still the, I think most of the original crew are still there. I mean, Ted Price, the guy who likes fairies.
Like is like a very soft term for what he said.
I've not actually seen if that's true or whatever. It's just I heard it on a different video. I heard it on,
So you're raising unsubstantiated.
Yeah, I know. It's like it's pretty much. It could be just pretty much the same thing as calling like Michael Jackson a pedo. what would be the actual term of people who enjoy fairies? I'll find that out. We'll find that out for the next part. But anyway, as I was saying, basically the entire Insomniac crew, including the president Ted Price, they came together in a video, basically just shitting on Trump. But they did it in a way. It wasn't quite that. They were basically trying to express how ridiculous the immigrant ban was. And yeah, they were.
There is no immigrant ban, but.
They were just, they just had a few, they were just explaining how a lot of the Insomniac team was made up of people from around the world, and I think it was actually quite touching, really.
Yeah.
But,
well, I don't trust the fairy lover, I'll tell you that, man.
I'm gonna have to find out to see if that is actually true. I just heard it on a video. But I think it probably is true, because I do enjoy this particular person's videos, so.
Alright.
What do you think to the, what do you think to the change in environment of going between all the shoots and everything? The vents, should I say.
Yeah, it's great. What I've just noticed about this is, like, often in sort of these kinds of games, when you're doing things like pushing a massive thing, it's really hard for them to, like, actually make it seem like they're pushing something, if that makes sense. The animation of this seems to actually be really good, like.
Do you think so? Yeah, that's one thing that I've pretty much repeated time and time again. The animations in this game, I think honestly they're better with Lara than the NPCs. Right. The NPCs are the difference between the animation is actually quite drastic, I would say. Like, they're not as good, but Lara's animation is just absolutely just, you know, superb. It's really good. But the
sublime.
Yeah, sublime, superlative.
Divine.
But the this is Tomb Raider looking its best, really, pretty much, because on the PS1 it doesn't look quite this good, because especially if you have the smoothing off, which obviously playing on a PS3 would give you that option. But I think a lot of the textures just look a lot better on the Mac than the PS1. They look incredible on the Mac and the PC, definitely.
Yeah.
But this is actually the final Venice level.
All right, then where do you go?
So after this, you go to the offshore rig, and it's really weird, actually. Like, you can... I did some lazy 20-minute research, so I don't know if it's actually true or not, but I was trying to find out where the offshore rig is placed, because I always assumed that it was just in the Mediterranean, because that would make sense coming from Venice. But there were loads of, like, pretty much from 20 minutes, all I could find at least was just kind of crappy speculations of just people saying, oh yeah, it's the Atlantic and stuff, but...
It's in the North Sea.
Yeah, it's just like off the coast from Skegness, from Skeggy Vegas.
Jesus.
Yeah. But
the other one, Palma del Skeg or something.
Costa del Skeg.
Costa, yeah, that one. Fucking hell.
So yeah, that's the control room, like I was saying earlier, and like you guessed, and
yeah, I could have guessed that.
Yeah, really. I think you did well. I couldn't even tell. So. But it changes the scenery on the stage, so you can then walk through it. I think that's pretty
smart. I think you need to read up on your Lara Croft lore.
My Lara Croft lore?
Yeah.
What, the lore of seeing what things are?
Yeah.
Seeing is believing. Is believing seeing?
Don't do that deep shit on me.
Deep shit from the Polar Express, you mean?
God.
Tom Hanks is a fucking guru.
All aboard.
It's a damn good film. Don't you even discriminate against it.
No, it is a good film. I haven't watched it for many years now.
I think, honestly, it's been about... That was the third secret, so I got loads of goodies. I got loads of ammo, and I think I got I got some Uzis as well, but I haven't seen that film for like literally probably 7 years, 6 years or something. But yeah, so this is the area so just up there is back to that area where you were saying you know the big area with the glass roof. So yeah. it all just comes back into the same area. It's just the use of
what is the like goal or like end of this level?
Yeah, you're pretty much supposed to. You're pretty much supposed to just be trying to find this Bartoli guy and to follow his trail. But like, honestly speaking, I think I think for the average person, you to find out exactly what you were supposed to be doing in a level, you honestly have to read the Tomb Raider wiki. Because I think, like, if you were to sit down an average gamer and get them to play this, they'd be like, okay, I'm just going to run around and just see what I can do. They don't really... I don't... Maybe I'm just, you know, speaking crap, but I mean, that's the general feeling I get. But what we're actually supposed to be doing is we're supposed to be going to see if we can... we're on the tail of this Bartoli guy because he is the guy responsible for trying to harness the power of this this ancient magic from China.
Alright.
And there's this dagger in particular that has this power, and obviously he's kind of like he really is just like a cult leader, because you can see how many like environments he has control over, and like this is like his lair. It's a really good idea for a lair in a way, just an opera house, an abandoned one. But
yeah,
it's actually it's quite close to the end of the level now, so And we...
Alright. I think I kind of remember this room for some reason. Just a room full of boxes.
You're probably... Yeah, maybe. Maybe... Maybe you've seen it before. It's quite...
Maybe I had a dream like this.
That as well. That could also be the case. This room as well, just like the sheer scale of some of these rooms. Like, Tomb Raider just... I can't think of any other fucking game where the developers would just be so casual with just making such huge rooms. Like in a second, like, I think I'll... Yeah, like, look at that. It's just fucking huge, and it just seems huger just because of the...
It's almost as high as the ceiling in my house.
Yeah, the Victorian... the Victorian... Would it be townhouse, something like that? But yeah, I have a question to ask. I hear you have knowledge of people changing the textures on Tomb Raider to pictures.
No, it's just this thing that I saw. Must have been a few years ago now.
A few years, yeah.
Yeah, it's just this person who shared this picture of like. They changed all the textures somehow in Tomb Raider on their computer. They changed every single texture to a picture of their dad. So, like, Lara Croft was just a picture of her dad. Of their dad. And so was, like, every... Like, if you were stood where you are right now in the video, every single thing would just be the face.
Trippy.
Shocking. It'd be even more of a bizarre dream.
I might actually I might see if I can experiment with that and upload some footage of that. So yeah, this is the end. This is the final room here, and this is our first kind of... He's not really a boss, he's just a stronger character. I guess he kind of is a boss in a way. Like, he just what is it he's got? I think, aren't they magnums or something? I think he's got two magnums.
I love how in every single PS1 game, it seems like magnum is just like the strongest gun you can possibly have.
Yeah, I know.
Like, isn't it the same in Resident Evil?
I can't even remember in Resident Evil. I think, yeah, I believe it is in Resident Evil, yeah. And it's also the same in Vice City.
Yeah. I don't know why it's like thought of as so.
Well, powerful. isn't it just the? I mean, yeah, the Colt 45, isn't that the same as the Magnum? The Colt 45, isn't Colt 45 really very similar, at least? Or it's either the same or very similar. But
yeah,
if you asked me as like an 11-year-old boy, I'd probably know.
That's just the sort of thing where, like, you as a 10-year-old would just be like, oh yeah, did you know Magnum is actually the strongest gun in the world?
I learned it from Resident Evil.
It's true, it has to be.
I saw it on the YouTube.
I saw it on Resident Evil.
Yeah, the, yeah, no, but that, yeah, I think it's actually really outdated as a weapon. I think you can find much stronger weapons there are obviously much stronger weapons now, like Desert Eagles and things, but yeah, I just think I don't know whether I wish it was that the NPCs had similar animations to Lara, but it's just, it does stick out a little bit, you got to admit, in a good way. I think it's kind of charming that I think
it sort of does make Lara seem more important.
Yeah, that's the thing. I suppose it's always going to be like that. But yeah, what we do in this... this is obviously a cargo room. And this is just a perfect example of just kind of how things would be on the PS1. Because you run straight into a plane. Not this thing here, but this plane here. And look at that skybox of Venice. It's literally just a huge... It's literally just a huge black cube with just some with just
some bad
buildings in the back.
I don't know, it's not that though. Like, it's good. for PS1 standards at that time, I guess.
Yeah, then we get a cutscene and
spooky.
You know what I think I'll do? I'll just I'll let you hear the I'll cut here and let you hear the actual audio.
Not quite the same now, is it?
Someday you will get a speeding ticket for that tongue, Fabio.
Hey, it's just a gut feeling that maybe you are wrong to look there.
Is your belief so fragile? Relax. Breathe deep. The gut, Fabio, has no more direction than a simple through and out. When my father left when I was a boy, he confided to me that he was enlightened. Echoed by something greater than impulse. He possessed the seraph. But he was just a disciple in this design. His death, plotting a path to be sought by the one, his son. You understand? Have faith, Fabio, not Gatrod. We are searching the right place.
I know it. I believe it, Marco.
Good. Eros, have you fixed that rail yet?
See!
So yeah, that was the end of the Opera House. So that was, I think I actually did pretty well in that part, but for a casual player. But yeah,
5 minutes.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, no, the voice acting does just sound like just like Italians who moved to the UK and just like try to pick up the accent.
Oh mate,
this just such a nice day.
Man, this game is spicy.
My favorite game on the PS1 is Need for Speed Hot Pursuit.
Pursuit.
But yeah, then you wake up in the offshore rig, so, and you obviously, because you're captured, you don't have any weapons. But I think you should come back in the next part, and you'll get to see more. I think actually the offshore rig is probably my. I like the level probably just as. I think the Opera House is my favourite level, and the Offshore Rig is probably my second favourite, actually. It's very good. But yeah, that pretty much wraps up for this part. So it is time to say goodbye. So yeah, until next time, goodbye.
See you.